Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to our online service here at Pompey Community Church. If you don't know me, my name is Wendell Fole. I'm the lead pastor here, and I want you to know I am so happy that you chose to be a part of our worship service this morning. As I was thinking about our service today, one of the things I thought, why do we continue to come together, even here online or even when we're able to come back to the church? And Psalm 95 jumped into my mind. So I want to read it to you this morning. The psalmist says this, "Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song." And here's why. "For the Lord is the great God, the great King above all gods." He continues down in verse 6. He says, "Come, let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, the flock under his care." God cares for us, he loves us, and he is worthy of our worship, he's worthy of our praise, and we can sing for joy. And so one of the things we want to do this morning is lift our voices together in praise to worship God. And so I'm going to ask you to pray with me before we do that, and if you could bow your heads with me, that would be awesome. Heavenly Father, thank you for this morning, a new day that you have made, a day that you are so fully aware of everything that we're going to experience and go through. And this is the day that you are worthy of praise. Every day you are worthy. So our desire this morning as we come together is to worship you, to lift our voices in praise, to hear your word so that we can be changed, so that we can become more like your son, Jesus. So we pray your blessing on our service. Please protect us. And I ask it in your name, Jesus. Amen. All right, let us join our voices in praise with those who are going to be leading us in worship this morning.
One, two, three, four.
Shout hallelujah, shout hallelujah unto God in three persons, blessed Trinity.
And I ran out of that grave. Out of the dark. saved, have been saved, will be saved. We bring a blessing now to the Father of our Savior, our one and living hope.
Well, good morning, PCC Church family, friends, and those of you who are visiting us for the first time. My name is Josiah Durfee. I'm the relatively new associate pastor here who serves alongside this wonderful staff and under our senior pastor, Wendell Full. I just hope you've had a great Sunday morning with us. I hope you've enjoyed our worship. We come to that part of our service where we will continue in our worship in the preaching of God's Word. And if you've been with us, you know that we are continuing, or we are in a sermon series, Our One and Living Hope, through the book of 1 Peter. So if you have your Bibles, I'm going to do something a little different. I'm going to read our passage, and then I'm going to say a quick word of prayer. But we're going to be looking at 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 1 through 11. We'll also have the verses on the screen for you if you don't have a Bible. But this is what the Word of the Lord says. Verse 1. Since therefore Christ suffered in the flesh, arm yourselves with the same way of thinking. For whoever has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin, so as to live for the rest of the time in the flesh no longer for human passions, but for the will of God. For the time that is past suffices for doing what the Gentiles want to do, living in sensuality, passions, drunkenness, orgies, drinking parties, and lawless idolatry. With respect to this, they are surprised when you do not join them in the same flood of debauchery, and they malign you. But they will give account to him who is ready to judge the living and the dead. For this is why the gospel was preached even to those who are dead, that though judged in the flesh the way people are, they might live in the spirit the way God does. Actually, I'm going to stop there, and I'm going to pick up in verse 7 when I get there later on in the sermon. But let's say a quick word of prayer, and let's get started. Heavenly Father, Lord God, we are so grateful for this time, Lord. I'm so glad for everyone who could join us this morning, Lord. I pray, Lord, that this would just be a time that is honoring to you, Lord, and that those who have been hungering after righteousness would be filled, Lord. And I just also want to pray, God, that whatever thoughts and burdens and concerns that the people here have come with, Lord, I pray, just in this time, would you dissipate that like a cloud in their mind so that they can focus on what it is that you have to teach us, Lord. May we be like open conduits to receive a new outpouring, a new filling of your grace and your glory, Lord. And so we praise you and we lift up to you this time. We ask all these things in your name, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Well, a shipwrecked man managed to wash ashore on an uninhabited island. While he was there, he built himself a hut to protect himself from the elements, and he stored much of what he was able to salvage from the shipwreck in his hut. Every evening, he would sit out on the beach looking at the horizon in hope that he would see some sails to come and rescue him. Well, one night when he was coming back from his adventures in the island, he noticed that his hut was enveloped in flames and that he had lost everything. He went to bed that night not knowing what he was going to do tomorrow. And yet he woke up and he saw something that he hadn't seen in many days. Just off the shore, there was a ship anchored there, and he saw a crew of men on a smaller boat coming towards him. When the boat arrived, the captain stepped ashore and said to the man, "We saw your smoke signal, so we came as fast as we could." You know, the man lost everything he owned, but it brought about his rescue and his salvation. You know, if you've been joining us in the book of 1 Peter, one of the themes that we've frequently been talking about is this theme of suffering. We've talked about why it is that God would allow unjust suffering. And I said to that we not only are exemplifying Christ, but we can't even imagine the unimaginable good that God could be bringing up as a result of that. We also looked at how it is that you and I are to respond in those situations, and that we don't return evil with evil, but we defeat malicious talk and these evil things with good. And then we also talked about how it is that God inevitably, praise the Lord, will get the final word in our situations, in our lives. And so while we may be falsely condemned and misjudged by the men of this world and false judges and corrupt systems or whatever, we know ultimately that the God of the heaven and earth is going to get the final word, and he is going to judge all of us. Well, I tell you this story about this maroon man to begin with because I think it's a really good story that tells us in many ways what it is that we're going to be talking about this morning, and that is sometimes God allows suffering in our life to show us, to teach us who it is that we are genuinely and truly worshiping. And for some of us this morning, we want to know, and we have this deep desire, longing within our hearts, Lord, do I belong to you, Lord? How is it that I can know? And that is our prayers that we lift up to God. And we just want to know, Lord, am I yours? Do I belong to you? Well, this is a great morning to be joining with us, because what Peter is going to provide for us is a little self-assessment test. But why do I say that sometimes God teaches us about who it is that we worship through times of suffering? Well, if you look at this passage here, there's this interesting phrase, right? He says, for whoever has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin. Isn't that an amazing thing? We have ceased from sin, those who have suffered in the flesh. Now, what is he talking about here? Is he talking about our ability to atone for our sins? Like, can we, if we suffer in the flesh, can we atone and accomplish the salvation that we need? That's not at all what he's talking about here. Is he talking about sinless perfection? You know, we have ceased from sin, that we are no longer able to sin. And that's not true either. What he is talking about here this morning, before we get into this little self-assessment test that Peter provides for us, is this. He's saying that those who have suffered in the flesh for their faith have demonstrated the genuineness of their belief and faith in God. And that means that they are no longer slaves to sin. They are no longer slaves to sin. They have ceased from it. They have put it away. Yes, we may sin, but what it means that through our suffering, we have shown ourselves true and genuine belief that God has implanted the message of his gospel deep within our own hearts. And let me give you a perfect example of this. The disciples of Jesus Christ. Remember, when Jesus was crucified, right? The disciples hid themselves in behind a locked door because they were afraid that the Jews who had the Roman proconsul that crucified Jesus, they were concerned that because they did that to their leader, the disciples were concerned about that. They didn't know what would happen to them. They were concerned. They were afraid for their lives. But you know the story. Jesus rose again on the third day, and then the disciples go out from there and they preach boldly the message of Jesus Christ, and all of them die martyrs' deaths. Now let me ask you this question. Oh, excuse me. I'm really sorry. I don't know why. I think I drank too much water or something. But I'm sorry. Let me ask you this question. What advantage did the disciples have in the first century to proclaim the message of Jesus Christ? Was there some type of social standing or benefit of that? Did they receive some type of special gifts or something of that kind? Did they become instantly popular? No, none of that is true. We know that all of the disciples, with the exception of one, died a martyr's death. Died a martyr's death, which goes back to our verse this morning, which is this. Nobody would die or nobody would suffer for something that they don't truly and genuinely believe in. And if that's the case, that might mean very possibly that Christ has not come into your life. Now, you and I live in America. We have the freedom to exercise and practice our religion and live for our faith. That's an incredible and wonderful blessing. So how does this apply to us? You and I are not suffering in the flesh. You and I are physically being beaten for being Christians, right? We're not at all. But let me give you this little way in which we can somewhat identify and associate with what this passage is talking about here. Are you standing for Christ in the conversations that you have with people in your life right now? And in those conversations you've had with people, do you find yourself intellectually abandoning ship, you know, neglecting and turning away from the gospel because, you know, you're afraid of being embarrassed. You're afraid of what the message of the cross means. Because I would bet that if we can't stand for Christ, even in our conversations with people, then you and I could not stand a chance in the world against suffering for what we believe in, and we definitely wouldn't be able to die for what it is that Christ tells us to. So he gives us this self-assessment test, but before he does, he tells us that we are to arm ourselves with the same way of thinking as Christ. We are to deliberately establish these pillars in our life and think after the thoughts of Jesus Christ. I think most of us think that our faith will just come to us. Like it'll just, one day we're going to walk out and it's just going to fall from the sky and it's going to hit us square in the head, you know? And that's not true. What Peter is saying is that we need to actively install or download, if you will, the thinking of Christ and have the same wavelengths and the same mindset. And that requires thinking, that requires the process of the mind. Because what he says to us very next in verse 2 is so important. He says, so as to live for the rest of the time in the flesh. Did you catch that? Did you see what Peter had just done here? He is picking up on a paradigm that we see all throughout Scripture, which is that right thinking leads to right living. Okay, let me say that again. Right thinking leads to right living because there is no way that we are going to be able to live out what Christ has called us to do if we have not actively and put into place the very mind of Christ in our life. And I'm going to talk more about that in just a minute. I'll come back to it. I'll circle around. But we're going to get into this self-assessment test that Peter has for us. And he's going to say, and what he's going to do is he's going to look at our behaviors. And the reason why he's going to be looking at our behaviors is because it's the easiest way for you and I to know whether or not we have been given the mind of Christ, which is an indication that we have a transformed heart, okay? A transformed heart. Now, so right thinking leads to right living. You know, in the Christian church today, we have done ourselves no favor by separating these two things. We have done ourselves no favors. And I hear this in so many conversations with faith leaders, other Christian students and others who just say, you know, Josiah, I really love God, but I don't really care about studying him. I really don't care about learning about him. I just want to live like a Christian. And in many ways, I get the sentiment. But when I hear that, you know what is coming across in my mind is this, you know, Josiah, it's like this statement, you know, Josiah, I want to go to the moon, but I don't really want to be an astronaut. You know, you can't do that. Those are two mutually incompatible statements. If we are called to live out what Christ wants us to, we have to have the mind of Christ and take on the mind of Christ. Yes, it's a grace that is given to us, but it's a mutual effort that we do. With God, we learn and we invest in the grace that he has given to us. So back to this test. Now we're going to get into it. Notice this emphasis on the flesh, right? Verse 1, since therefore Christ suffered in the flesh. At the end of verse 1, for whoever has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin. Verse 2, so as to live for the rest of the time in the flesh, no longer for human passions, right? Fleshly. And then verse 3, he gives us a list of all of these outward sins that we do against our body: sensuality, passions, drunkenness, orgies, drinking parties, and lawless idolatry. So I've already said the reason why he focuses on these outward behaviors is that it's the easiest way for us to like empirically see whether or not we are genuinely and truly a follower of Jesus, Christ. And so what I want you to do this morning is, just as we go through this, is just have this question in the back of your mind. How do you do? How do you do in comparison to what it is that Peter tells us that should not characterize our life? How do you do? So very simply, do you still participate in these outward things? Do you still participate in these outward things? Sensuality, which is the desire to fill yourself up with sexual pleasures. That's where you to find your meaning in these things, and passions and drunkenness. Do you find yourself falling into these very outward public signs of debauchery that he calls them? He says, you do not join them in the same flood, the flood of debauchery. But one other thing I want to add to this is what Paul says in Romans chapter 1, because it's not only those who participate in this, but it's also those who give approval to these kinds of behavior. Paul gives his own list in Romans chapter 1, beginning in verse 29. He says this, I'll read the list, and then listen to the end. There's a little bit of a nuance here, but let me read his list first. Verse 29. They were filled with all murder, strife, deceit, maliciousness. They are gossips, slanderers, haters of God, insolent, haughty, boastful, inventors of evil. And listen to this one. This is just an interesting one. He says disobedience to parents. Keep in mind everything I just said, and he puts this one in here, disobedient to parents. He goes on in verse 31, foolish, faithless, heartless, ruthless. Verse 32, though they know God's righteous decree that those who practice such things deserve to die, they not only do them, but give approval to those who practice them. So back to 1 Peter, and with the help of Paul, do you not only participate in these things, but do you give approval to them? Do you turn a blind eye when you see it? And do you know people in your life, siblings, maybe it's your son or your daughter, who are actively engaged in this kind of lifestyle? Do you give approval to that kind of lifestyle? Because you are just as equally a culpable for this lifestyle if you give approval to it. And this is, after all, right, what repentance means. God has called us out of the life that we formerly lived, and we renounce that kind of life, not only in our own lives, but in the lives of those who are closest to us and those who are around us. You know, Jesus graphically illustrates this. You know, if your hand causes you to sin, he says, cut it off. You know, if your eye causes you to sin, pluck it out, for it is better to enter into heaven maimed than to go into eternal fire with your arms in your eyes. It's a physical picture that Jesus is using of a serious and frightening spiritual reality, which is, if we don't deal with sin rightly, if we don't cut it off and remove it from our lives, we run a huge risk of putting ourselves into serious, serious danger. And so oftentimes our outward behavior reflects whether or not an inward change has happened in our heart. Peter goes on here, and what he tells us is this, as it applies to us. Does your new relationship with Christ affect your other relationships in this world? Right? In verse 4, he says, respect to this, they are surprised when you do not join them in the same flood of debauchery. And it tells us how they respond. They will malign you. They will malign us. Is there something surprising about the way you live, that when other people look at you, they say, wow, that is an incredible act of compassion? Are you outdoing others in honor? Or is it what you're finding in your life is that you are just playing along in the same rhythms and harmonies of this unbelieving world? Is there something surprising, distinguishing and noticeably different about how you behave? Because in this new nature that Christ has given to us, we have spiritually metamorphed into a new being, just as the caterpillar is no longer a caterpillar when it goes into the cocoon and turns into this beautiful and wonderful butterfly. And I love this language that Peter uses here about living, right? He says, are you living out your life in this kind of way? Okay, now let me make it an important difference. There is a difference between actively, deliberately fighting against these things and then just willfully and freely letting yourself fall into this as like a default mode of existence. You know, I used to live in a ranch-styled house. I was born and raised, I was raised in a ranch house with my family that was across from the farm. And it's a great house. But in that house, I also have a lot of bad memories, okay? I didn't treat my siblings as well as they deserved. I didn't respect my parents as well as they should have. And it's, you know, a place of bad memories. But now I don't live there anymore. I may visit there, right? But I have a new zip code. I have a new address. So have you been given a new spiritual zip code, a new spiritual address in your heart? And listen, I understand, even at myself, that we may visit our former ways of life, but do you live there? No, I hope that is not true for any of us, and it tells us that they will malign us. Verse 5 reminds us also of a theme that we've already talked about, which is this: but they will give account to him who is ready to judge the living and the dead. You know, whatever man thinks about us, we have peace in knowing that God sees everything. He knows the truth, right? He's not just omnipresent, he's omniscient, right? He knows all things, and he will judge all of us, and he will see in us what the true truth is. And those who punish us, those who mistreat us, will have to stand before the judge of all of the earth. And then he says, down in verse 7, he's going to give us really the motivation, why it is that we are to renounce this and stiff arm this kind of behavior in our life. Verse 7 begins like this: the end of all things is at hand. So the reason why Christ invites us out of this life that we formerly were living in is not only because God has given us a new nature, but also because he has given us a great responsibility to serve him. And he begins by saying, remember, the end of all things is at hand. You know, I remember growing up in the church, the older, wiser men would always say, the end is at hand, you know. And every time when they'd say that, I would think in my mind, what are they talking about? Are they talking about the way in which this previous generation has been brought up and they don't like how that's going, and so they're beating this deadbeat drum about how things are going to end, and you know, they're getting closer to their graves, and they're just saying, you know, I've heard that a lot in the church, and I couldn't figure out why it is that they were saying that. And keep in mind, I'm the younger guy, I'm the younger man, and let me say this: the Bible says nothing good about younger men. That's just an aside. And but I found out that they were right. You know, they were right. We are living in the end times. Jesus' disciples were living in the end times when Jesus ascended into heaven, right? The disciples asked, is it at this time that you are going to restore the kingdom? And Jesus doesn't rebuke them, because the answer is yes. You know, Jesus says, in effect, by not answering the question, you are to be my witnesses, so that there could be a great ingathering of believers, so that when Jesus comes next, we will be ready and we will be prepared. And another reason why here is this: idea that the Bible gives us in 1 Thessalonians 5 and in other passages, the reason why we're not supposed to participate in these behaviors is because it tells us that the coming of the Son of Man is going to be like a thief in the night. In Matthew chapter 24, Jesus says that two people will be in the field and one will be taken out, right? So we need to be ready for this. We need to be ready. I remember when I was playing baseball as a young in Little League, they put me in the outfield, and supposedly they put the bad players in the outfield, but I believe they actually put the stronger players out there because you had to throw the ball all the way to home plate. But the reason why they put the weaker players out in the outfield was because a lot of the kids, because we were in Little League, couldn't hit the ball past the infield. You know, we couldn't even hit it out of the infield, I should say. And so I did what most people did when they were playing baseball in the outfield. I just played with the grass and the dandelions out there. And I remember my coach would always say, "Durfee, get in that ready position." You know, and the ready position was this. You know, you'd put your hands on your knees, you'd crunch down, and you would just wait. And you would wait and hope that a ball would come your way. And sometimes it would, and it could determine the game. And what Jesus is telling us is that we need to be in our ready position. We need to be prepared. There's a sense of urgency that should characterize our life. And he says, in light of that, we need to be self-controlled, sober-minded for the sake of our prayers. These are things that are required of us in order to be ready, to be attentive to what God has for us. And then in verse 8, he says, "Above all, keep loving one another earnestly, since love covers a multitude of sins." You know, love in the church is like duct tape. It's like the duct tape of ministry, okay? It has universal application and can be used to fix just about anything. And he says we are to love one another earnestly. Now keep in mind, we are to love everyone. You know, Jesus says that we are to love our enemies and pray for those who persecute us. But in our context this morning, what Peter is focusing on, what's in his mind, is the relationships that we have with other believers. We are to love each other earnestly. That is to say, we are to have this love that is stretched out. And what does that look like? That means that we give others the benefit of the doubt, right? We don't make negative assumptions. And I think we also need to hear that, especially now in light of all these racial tensions that are going on in this world. You know, it's this thinking that, oh, if you said this, you must be this kind of person. Oh, because this person has said this, you must be that kind of person. And we must avoid that. I mean, we ought to just stop doing that. Stop with these negative assumptions, because a love that stretches, this is an incredible thing, covers a multitude of sins. You know, what Peter is inviting us to do is don't get hung up on the little things, okay? Listen, just have this at the forefront of your mind, or as a prerequisite or something. We live in a fallen, broken world, and even as Christians, we're going to make mistakes, okay? I'm going to be the first one to admit it. You know, I make mistakes all the time. Sometimes I say really bad things, dumb things, you know. But if we know their hearts, if we know that they are believers, can we extend to these the benefit of the doubt and not condemn us and throw stones at each other? He continues on in verse 9. We are to show hospitality to one another without grumbling. In the first century, Christians would move from house to house. And so what that required of you was to open up your home. And really what an open home means is an open heart. When you are bringing in, you're inviting people into your home, what you're saying is, really, you are a part of my family. At least, you know, I want to take care of you. And I trust you with my possessions. I trust you to be in the places that are most vulnerable to me, my family. And so we are to be hospitable. Don't do this with a sense of grumbling and regret. In many ways, it almost seems like we shouldn't do it if that is going to be the case. But in verse 10 and 11, I want to just read out and finish up what Peter has for us. He says this, "As each has received a gift, use it to serve one another as good stewards of God's varied grace. Whoever speaks is one who speaks oracles of God. Whoever serves is one who serves by the strength that God supplies, in order that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. To him belong glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. You know, it may seem like at the end of this that it feels like Christians and what God is calling us to do is a total and complete killjoy. You know, and we wonder, like, great, you know, am I not going to have any fun? Can I not, how am I going to live an exciting life? Well, here's something way better than anything that Christ calls us to renounce. He has given us gifts. He has equipped us. It says that we are to be stewards of these gifts. A steward was usually a slave in the first century who would oversee the businesses and the property. And while the slave didn't own the business, while the slave did not own the property, he was stewarding it. He was watching over it. He was investing in it and procuring the tools that he would need and other slaves and laborers if that was required. What God has given us is that he has installed within us a grace to do his work, to be a part of his ministry. And he gives to us gifts of speaking and service and strength so that we can serve and worship a real king. There is a real kingdom, and there is a real throne, and there is a real king that is sitting upon that throne. And he gives us a purpose and a meaning that transcends, that goes above anything and any reward or whatever status we may have in this life, that is more precious to us than the most precious diamonds and jewelry in the world. And that is to serve the living God himself. I don't think there is a greater calling in this life than to be a part of his kingdom advancing work and to glorify his great and mighty name. And so that's all I have for us this morning. I'm so glad that you could join us. I hope you have a great Sunday. Have a great week. And remember, we have ministries happening all across this week. And we love you guys. We're praying for you. And I just hope you have a great week. God bless everyone.
Once again, Josiah, thank you for bringing God's word to us this morning. I'm so grateful for all the hard work that you put into your messages, and I pray that each of us will be encouraged to live just a little differently and to deal with the difficulties of life that come our way. I have a few things that I want to just wrap up our service with, some announcements. That one thing for sure is, if you don't listen or hear everything I say, you can always go to our webpage, poppychurch.org. You can find everything that's going on at the church. You can also pay attention to our social media, to our Facebook and our Instagram. But here's a few things. Number one, if you as a family have somebody who is graduating this year, we want to honor all of our seniors, all of our graduating seniors. So if you could give the church a call, that would be great. And leave their name, and we'll get back to you about some of the things that we'd like to be able to share. You've also maybe heard of a Connect and Care team. This team's purpose is to be able to connect with folks who might not be a part of a growth group or a team ministry of some sort. And we want to make sure that people aren't left out, and want to be able to check on them and make sure they're okay. So if you know people that we should connect with, please let us know that. But even more importantly, if you would like to help us with that, that would be wonderful. It could be as simple as a phone call. So call the church office, and again, leave your name, and we'll get back to you with all those details. We also want you to know that if you want to use the church grounds to be able to get together as a growth group or an event that's small, we want to encourage that. We want you to know that we want you to be able to come up, of course, stay socially distanced and obey all the rules that we've been given. We also want you to know that if you also want to use the church building itself, that is also okay. Now, we do have some restrictions and some guidelines that really will make sure that we're doing in compliance. So if you want to do that, you can call the church office, and we'll get back to you, and you can check out all the things that will need to be in place so that you can do that. So again, watch the website and you'll find all those details. A last thing, if you could take your calendars out and you could block out Friday, June 26th, and potentially the 27th, Saturday, we are planning a PCC fellowship event outside to be able to get us all together as the body and enjoy just seeing each other and getting to catch up. We've got some fun things planned to be able to do that. So mark it down. You'll see more details coming in the future. If you could be praying for that, that would be great. So I want to encourage you, continue to be the hands and the feet and the voice of Jesus to those that you come in contact with. Look for ways that you can minister to folks who might need to be reminded of God's great love. And I pray that this week would be a week of blessing and a week that God gets to use you. So thank you, and God bless you. Have a great day.